All right. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Atkinson Congregational Church. We are the light on the hill. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. A special welcome to those of you visiting for the first time or the first time in a long time or the first time virtually. We're very glad that you could join us. I invite you to find out more about the light on the hill on our website or on our Facebook page. Both of those web addresses are on the bottom of your welcome screen in front of you. Part of our worship today is responsive prayers, and so you're invited to say the words that are in bold. Please keep your microphone muted unless you have an assigned part in the course of our worship. Every Thursday evening from 6 to 8, we are still running virtual fellowship. The link for that and more information about that is on the home page of our website. We'd love to have you join us for that. And we will worship again next Sunday at 10 a.m., July 5th, and next Sunday will be a communion Sunday, so please have elements with you for communion next Sunday. This week's children's message has been posted on our YouTube channel. There's a link to it on our Facebook page as well. And a very special welcome this morning to the members and friends of Pilgrim United Church of Christ Kingstred Brentwood who have joined us for worship this morning while their pastor, the Reverend Tara Olson Allen, is taking a well-deserved break. And they are going to return the favor to us on July 19th when I will be on vacation. If you'd like to sign up for our newsletter or find out more about what's going on at the Light of the Hill, you can use the Contact Us form on the website, and that will get you in contact with the staff who will then assist you in any way that they can. If you are part of our Zoom worship, you are invited to put any prayer requests, type them into the Zoom group chat window. And those will be collected during the first third or so of our service and then made part of our collective prayers. I think that is all we have for announcements this morning. And so friends, let's begin our worship as we always do with our call to worship, which is printed on your screen, and we will say it responsively. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Sing of God's unalterable love.
We will rejoice as we walk in the light of our God.
Tell everyone around you of God's faithfulness.
We will share the stories of the one who experienced our life in all its fullness.
Shout out loud of God's presence with us on this day and in all the days to come.
Justice and goodness are God's gifts to us. Truth and love walk by our side.
Our opening hymn this morning is Here I Am to Worship by Tim Hughes. The words will be on your screen. I invite you to sing along.
Darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Humbly you came to the earth.
Let us pray. Lord, we want to follow you wherever you will lead. Reach out to us this day, stirring our souls and spirits with the winds of your power, that we may faithfully be your disciples. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, the idol of our times is personal independence. But in truth, we get bossed around by our faults, our poor choices, the hurts that we cause others. Yet by God's grace, we are set free from all of these passions. So let us join in offering our confessions to the one who welcomes each of us with forgiveness and hope as we say together our unison prayer of confession. It seems so simple, God of compassion, to offer a cup of cold water to a thirsty person. Yet we know we worry more about how that might inflate our bill at the end of the month. We are to open our hearts to others, but they may need to be careful lest they slip on our icy attitudes towards them. People are looking for places to lay their heads, yet our spare bedrooms continue to be the place where only the dust bunnies sleep. Forgive us, radical hope. You did not have to become one of us, but you did, so we might know your love. You did not have to welcome us into your family, but you do, so we might experience unexpected grace in our lives. You did not have to die for us, but in Jesus Christ you did, so we might have life with you forever. Broken, we are made whole. Thirsty, we are filled with living water, longing for a renewed relationship with God. We are welcomed with open arms by the one who forgives us.
Without a doubt, God's love never comes to an end. We will tell our kids and grandkids of the grace and peace which is ours. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. Amen. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning is Psalm 13. We'll read it responsively, and our reader this morning is Darlene Gracing.
How long will you forget me, Lord? Forever? How long will you hide your face from me?
How long will I be left to my own wits?
Agony filling my heart daily. How long will my enemy keep defeating me?
Look at me. Answer me, Lord my God. Restore sight to my eyes. Otherwise, I'll sleep the sleep of death, and my enemy will say, I won. My foes will rejoice over my downfall.
But I have trusted in your faithful love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation. Yes, I will sing to the Lord because you have been good to me.
We now enter into our prayer time, and we'll begin with the reciting the prayer requests that have come into our office during the past week, and also those that have been shared in this morning's chat window. And I invite our internet deacon, Mark Miller, to begin.
A special wife and daughter. Answered prayers. Emily and Daisy. Baby Clay and his family. Beth. Safe and great health. Martha and family, thankful for answered prayers. Peace and comfort for the Cassidy family on the passing of their mom and grandma. Prayers of healing for Gloria Dodge and Gloria Cohn. Continued prayers for Dick Nealon and Priscilla Robinson. Prayers for our military and families. Linda Rousseau, Brenda Bell, Darlene Atkinson, and Dick Gardella. Prayers for our country. Let's fix this. Lord, help us fix this. Strength for Patty Gourley. Rest in peace, Dot Schmidt. Thank you, God, for another beautiful day. Comfort for the Tracy family. Prayers for healing. Prayers for Samantha. Prayers for Gloria Dodge as she recovers from a motor vehicle accident. Healing prayers for Matt, Joyce, Kristen, and Marika. Prayers for Jan and Kim. Prayers of thanks for the good health of my family. Thank you, God, for the blessing of a much-needed vacation. Prayers for our dear friends, all in the final stages of cancer, entrusting themselves to God. Thank you for answered prayers. Strength and healing for Richard. A healing path for us. Praise God for nature. Prayers for my family, especially Verna. Melissa for peace and happiness. Ginny, Cooper, Connie, Cheryl, and Mel. Healing and a job for RG and CG. Healing for our country, and prayers for the family of Sally on her passing on Friday. Lord, hear our prayers.
Let us pray. Lord, we talk so easily about being a friendly church. We like to think of ourselves as a place where everyone is welcomed. But our welcome should not stay confined to ourselves. We are called to adopt attitudes of hospitality to others who may not return the favor. We are called to be willing to take the risk of hospitality in our workplace, our homes, our community, everywhere we go. You reached out to people in all kinds of conditions. Many of those people were rejected by their society, their families. They were in need of compassionate greeting and friendship. Lord Jesus, as you have welcomed us, regardless of our faults and failings, let us also be a welcoming presence to all in your name. Most holy and majestic God, creator of the earth, ruler of the stars, nourish in us a sense of awe and mystery and wonder. Help us in times of difficulty to ponder the things you have done, and assist us to meditate on how you have provided. Indeed, God, grant us the faith of Abraham and the understanding that God brings to Abraham, that we are to trust in the one who gives us all things and not things themselves. Eternal One, we thank you for our Bible, which documents your love affair with humankind. We thank you for the words of Jesus, which remind us of our need to be welcoming. We thank you that you continually stretch us to reach beyond ourselves. And so, God, stretch us. Stretch us to widen our souls to include others of your children that we might naturally exclude. Stretch us to grasp more than we think that we can reach. Stretch us to believe in ourselves and others. Stretch us to support and encourage others. Stretch us to offer a cup of cold water and food and shelter and a safe haven in your name. For all who suffer and need your special grace, we lift up our prayers today. We pray, O God, to those individuals and those situations you have placed on our hearts. We pray with thanksgiving and hope for ourselves and for those who are named before you. And bless, O God, all those for whom we now ask for from the silence of our hearts. God, grant us and your whole church the courage to speak out against all evil and to make no peace with oppression or violence or the manipulation of truth in order that we may be comfortable in our own self-deceit. Stir in us the will for justice between ourselves and our children and within our community and our nation and our world. Teach us your ways and lead us to your paths of righteousness. For the sake of him who laid down his life for us, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing together our prayer response. Friends, love is a powerful force in the world, stronger than hatred or fear or greed. The love of Jesus inspires us and makes us able to share generously the gifts that we have received from God. Our gifts are one way that we love one another and the world around us, the world that God loves. Let us be as generous with our giving as our God has been, with love, with mercy, and with gifts poured out into our lives. We invite your support of our ongoing ministries, whether you give online or by mail or Dropbox at the office entrance at 101 Main Street in Atkinson. And remember that you never walk alone.
Golden sky and full
Our second scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Genesis, the 22nd chapter, verses 1 through 14. Today's lesson from Genesis directly follows last week's message that we heard, which was the story of the banishment of Hagar and Ishmael. After these events, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham." Abraham answered, "I'm here." God said, "Take your son, your only son whom you love, Isaac, and go to the land of Moriah. Offer him up as an entirely burnt offering there on one of the mountains that I will show you." Abraham got up early in the morning, harnessed his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, together with his son Isaac. He split the wood for the entirely burnt offering, set out, and went to the place God had described to him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place at a distance. Abraham said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will walk up there, worship, and then come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the entirely burned offering and laid it on his son Isaac. He took the fire and the knife in his hand, and the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father, Abraham, "My father." Abraham said, "I'm here, my son." Isaac said, "Here is the fire in the wood, but where is the lamb for the entirely burnt offering?" Abraham said, "The lamb for the entirely burnt offering, God will see to it, my son." The two of them walked on together. They arrived at the place God had described to him. Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He tied up his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to kill his son as a sacrifice. But the Lord's messenger called out to Abraham from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." Abraham said, "I'm here." The messenger said, "Don't stretch out your hand against the young man and don't do anything to him. I know now that you revere God and didn't hold back your son, your only son, from me." Abraham looked up and saw a single ram caught by its horns in the dense underbrush. Abraham went over, took the ram, and offered it as an entirely burned offering instead of his son. Abraham named that place, "The Lord Sees." That is the reason people today say, "On this mountain, the Lord is seen." Thus ends our readings from Scripture this day, and may God lend God's understanding to our hearing of God's word. Our middle hymn this morning is called "Blessed Assurance." It's by Elevation Worship. The words will be on your screen. Please sing along. Friends, this past week, one of the preaching lists I belong to on the internet just went completely crazy. Instead of the usual 10 or 20 emails a day, there were up to 60 or 70 every day. On other lists, it was much the same. All of it was occasioned by the Old Testament reading. I just read the story of God testing Abraham by asking him to sacrifice his son Isaac on Mount Moriah. Now, normally I preach on the gospel lesson, occasionally the epistle, and I intended to preach on the gospel this morning, a nice, tidy little sermon about how one glass of water can make a difference to those who need it and our call to provide it when we can. It's a theme that many of you would recognize. But these last 2 weeks, these stories about Abraham, this difficult story which has a name, would not let me off so easily. You know, many pastors ignore or redact this passage from Genesis from the Sunday's readings, preferring not to deal with it. But for better or for worse, my head and my heart would not allow it. So here we go. I said this passage has a name. It's called the Akedah, which means binding, or the binding of Isaac. The story of the Akedah in the scripture is one of the very few stories in the Old Testament that has a name. It's the story of Abraham who bound his son Isaac, laid him upon an altar, and lifted a knife with every intention of sacrificing his own son in obedience to a God who was really only testing him. It's the most famous, or the most troubling, or perhaps I should say the most famously troubling of the stories held in common between Jews and Christians and Muslims, the Akedah, the binding. Now, if you were someone who didn't regularly attend religious services and you wandered into our virtual worship this morning, you may be sitting on your couch right now thinking, this is precisely why I don't go to church. You may be secretly thinking to yourself that you're not sure which is worse, having to listen to this kind of twisted, abusive, misguided, patriarchal rhetoric, or watching a well-intentioned pastor do his very best to warm up and admittedly contort this ancient story into something akin to chicken soup for the modern soul. Well, all I can say is, or you may be sitting there thinking, yeah, right, the story of Abraham, that's the one about the guy whose faith was so great, he was even willing to sacrifice his own son, but hey, he passed the test, right? God let him off the hook, and they all lived happily ever after, which just goes to show you that, God won't give you more than you can handle. Or maybe it's more like, if God closes a door, God opens a window. Or is it just that when bad things happen to good people, it's really that just God's testing them, and if they would just buck up, it would soon be over. So really, God is just telling us to trust God even more. Or is the true moral of the story that we should love God even more than we love our children? Well, if I may be so bold. Soren Kierkegaard opened his famous treatment of this story in Fear and Trembling by admitting that he loves this story as a child and paradoxically came to admire it more and more throughout his years, while admittedly understanding it less and less. and less. And I think that's how it should be. Before I take a humble stab at what I think the story is about, I want to give you a chance to think about it again. I'm going to pause for a minute or so of silence, and I want you to consider this story yourself. What sort of questions does this story raise for you, or what do you find hard about it? Or perhaps I would do better to ask, what don't you find hard? Where does it snag at your conscience or cause you to wonder about the nature of Scripture, or maybe the goodness of God, or what does it mean to be truly faithful? So friends, I'm going to pause for just a moment. I invite you to think about what questions you have about this story. Perhaps you thought of questions like, does God really test us? Or, wait a minute, didn't Abraham have two sons? If Abraham would argue for the lives of good people in Sodom and Gomorrah, why would he not argue with God for the life of his own son? Or, does God really value child sacrifices? Or, is it okay to kill people if God tells you to do it, or in the name of God, or for the glory of God? Well, those are some good questions. Perhaps you had some more as well. I know I'm probably preaching to the choir saying this in the United Church of Christ congregation, but it's good to question the Scriptures. We actually encourage it. It's healthy to wonder and wrestle and even at times disagree, because for one thing, if you're going to engage Scripture at that level, it's a mark of how much you care. And for another, the Bible isn't some sort of answer book where you can just flip through the pages, pick a verse, and divine a course of action for your life. It wasn't assembled like this from Genesis to Revelation just to tell you as an individual living in the 21st century exactly how to think and what to do in any given situation. It's more a gift of wisdom collected over 1,000 years to help you, God willing, to learn to think for yourself and discern through reading and prayer and meditation, alone and in community. Otherwise, at least in the case of this story, we'd all be aspiring to become wealthy, male, slave-holding, child-sacrificing polygamists. And that's not the message I want you to leave with this morning. A colleague by the name of Lawrence DeWolf gave a wonderful sermon on this story right after September 11th. You can imagine how it would have resonated then with a whole host of people killing others in the name of God, within which he quoted the biblical scholar James Sanders, who once said that we have to stop looking at the Bible as a manual for morality and begin to see it as a mirror of our own identity. Lawrence continues, we can't take a story like this one and say, there it is, God wants us to act like Abraham. What we must do with Bible stories like this one, and there are many like this one, is to look at them and see God in humanity and relationship. To see a truth about ourselves and God that we can't find anywhere else. Mirrors don't show us what we want to see, says Lawrence. What's most important about mirrors is they show us what we can't see on our own. So if this is not a story about how parents should act or how we should love God more than we love even our own children, what is it a story about? And honestly, I think even that's the wrong way to ask the question or approach the test, because it implies that there's a moral. And I don't think that there's a neat and tidy moral to the story. For all the obvious parallels, this isn't a grim fairy tale or an Aesop's fable or even a Greek myth. It's the story of a man named Abraham, who had been called by God decades ago to leave his father's house and travel to a land that God would show him. It's a story of a man who was promised by the same God that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky and the grains of sand upon the earth. It's a story of a man who believed and waited faithfully, if we sidestep for now that unfortunate event with Hagar, until he was 100 years old before his beloved wife Sarah did conceive and bear a child, one child, and that child was Isaac. If we look at this story as DeWolf suggests, the way one looks at a mirror, what do we see about ourselves? Well, I don't think that means that we use the story as a crystal ball. We're not looking into it to see who we should be or even who we will be, but as the mirror reflects, we see who we are right now. If we look into the mirror of this text at the face of our fellow traveler, Abraham, we see a man who first and foremost had great faith in the promises of God, enough faith to leave the country of his birth, travel to a new land, engage in battles, argue with God, maintain hope over many desolate years, and even let his first son, and we'll come back to the problem of Abraham having two sons, but the text says your only son, even let his son Ishmael go off into the desert with the promise that God would provide for him as well. And now, in his old age, Abraham finally has the pleasure of cherishing the fulfillment of God's promise in the form of his last remaining son, Isaac. So looking at this all, I wonder, is it possible that this same Abraham, after all that he had been through, had come to a place where he put just a little too much trust in his beautiful son, Isaac? Is it possible that Abraham, in his later years, reflects our very human tendency to place our hope, ground our sense of security, and even come to worship or make holy, which is actually the Latin meaning of sacrifice, to make holy, the gifts of God rather than God, God who is the giver of all good gifts? Is it possible that we have a tendency to place our trust more in the gift than the giver? Is it thus possible, or perhaps even true, that after years of hard work, served unbegrudgingly with great love and faith, that we get to a place of comfort and security where we, as churches and individuals, trust more in what we have been given than in the giver of all those good gifts? I remember after Elizabeth, our oldest, was born, lying awake at night in my bed, terrified that something might happen to her, trying to hear her breathing from down the hall, rather than simply enjoying the wonderful gift that that child was, well, most of the time, and trusting that the God who had brought this person into my life would love me and care for me and provide for me no matter what happened. The point is, there are gifts that come into our lives that we fear we cannot live without. It is, I believe, part of what it is to be human. Perhaps the story about Abraham and Isaac is here to teach us that we can and will go on living no matter how much we lose, because we will always have God. Phyllis Tribble was a professor at Union Seminary whose name may be familiar to those of you who watched that PBS program about Genesis with Bill Moyers, and she said that the literary key to this text is found in the words, "Take your son, your only son whom you love, Isaac." For these words, in a story known for its sparseness, belabor just how precious Isaac is to Abraham. There is a Jewish midrash or interpretation that touches on this as well. It also serves to explain why Isaac is referred to as an only son. Told you I'd come back to that. In the midrash, this sentence that Tribble points to is actually seen as one side of a conversation between God and Abraham. So the line, "Take your son, your only son, whom the one whom you love, Isaac," when coupled with Abraham's response to God, sounds something more like this. God, "Abraham, take your son." Abraham, "Which son?" "Your only son." "I have two sons, the one whom you love. But Yahweh, I love both of my sons." "Isaac." "Oh, I was afraid you meant that one." In that one line, Isaac is revealed to Abraham as his most beloved son, and indeed the most beloved of all things. Tribble says that the gift, meaning the boy, has become a substitute for the giver, meaning God. Abraham is in danger of worshiping his son, who to him represents the fulfillment of a promise in the future, instead of God, who holds the future and made the promises in the first place. The fact that Abraham would go to such lengths and actually intend to sacrifice his son, remember, sacrifice means to make holy, serves to underscore this imbalance to Abraham. And so in testing Abraham in this way, God reminds him that his son is a gift, but the future is not in Isaac's hands. It's in God's hands. And even if something terrible happened to Isaac, God could and would find a way to fulfill the promise. So perhaps Abraham's faithfulness was not so much proven that day, but who could have doubted his faithfulness, but refined and reoriented to focus more fully on the sovereignty of God. It's a thought. We all have a tendency to get attached to those things we love the most here on earth and come to trust in them for our sense of well-being. We come to trust more in the gifts of God that God's given us, be they people or homes or jobs or churches, than we trust in God, because those things give us hope for the future. The Akedah is a powerful and painful reminder that all these earthly blessings shall come to pass, whereas God, the giver, will still be forever and always, as God has always been, the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, as God was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen and amen. This is the God we serve. This is the God who gives us all. So, my friends, thank be to God. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is, Lord, whose love and humble service. Please sing along. The words will be on your screen. Friends, I will offer a benediction for our departing, and then we will sing together our benediction response. And then after that, I will turn off the screen share and invite you to turn on your video and your audio, and we will greet each other with a holy blessing before we depart. And so, my friends, go in peace, love, and care for one another in the name of Jesus. May the holy God provide for you in mercy. May Christ Jesus welcome you as you welcome the stranger. And may the Holy Spirit lead you in the ways of eternal life this day and every day. Amen. Greetings, everyone. Very good to see you all. Thanks for being part of our worship today. I hope you have a wonderful and blessed week, and we'll see you again next Sunday.
Thank you.
Have a great week, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hello, everybody.
Thank you, Jim. What a wonderful sermon.
I know. You just say goodbye. Goodbye.
Bye, everybody.
God bless everybody.
Bye. Bye. Hey, Jane.
Have a good week.
Oh, did we miss Jane? I was going to say, if she noticed the size of that back row of bells.
What was that?
Jane, you are still there. Did you see that back row of the bells?
Oh, yes, of course. Yes. Wonderful.
That must be a serious workout. He must be like a weightlifter to swing those things around.
That's right.
I was in that church 40 years ago. It has changed quite a bit.
Oh, that's amazing. We had a bell practice this morning, didn't we, Darlene?
We did. Yes, we did. 6 feet apart, mass. We were safe.
Good, good.
So we all got together. Mm-hmm. We'll see you in September, I guess.
Jim, I did have the service was very much like an old-time service, because there were the birds squabbling like kids in the background, and the cat got squirmy and irritated during the middle of your sermon and tried to get up and leave.
Amazing.
You could have been in the sanctuary, huh?